work in fashion for 23 years because my mom taught me how to knit, and I was 6 years old when I knitted my first deck, and I was really proud of it, although it didn't make sense because it was, we were in Armenia, it was a jacket, in Armenia it's 40 degrees, you know. Anyway, so there was one of those quotes that I got from Lima in the court. She was saying that fashion is dead, and I have been researching fashion where I went a bit too far. I made a timeline of 50 meters of 6,000 years researching society and fashion. And what I can say is that fashion is not dead. Only the system in which we are now for the past 200 years, that is dead. Because it started with the idea of fashion designers becoming more autonomous, like they're showing what their ideas are. They started creating collections and selling it. It started with haute couture, with Charles Worth, and then it went further to confection in the shops, prêt-à-porter, and so on. And the reality of fashion as we see now in the daily lives is this in the shops, and the quality is quite low. So what is the reality of the fashion industry right now is that yearly there are 80 billion kilos of textiles being produced. So that's quite a lot. But 30% of the clothes that are produced from these textiles are not sold because they are just not wanted. So we have 30% overproduction. That means 30% too much use of water, electricity, packaging, transportation, and so on. So I thought I had researched sustainability first, then fashion, then the core of fashion and everything. But I thought if we only switch to sustainable production, but we don't change anything about the way clothes are being designed and created, we're going to have 30% sustainable waste. And that's not what we should, you know, go for. So I looked into the way the fashion or clothes are being designed, and what I found was that a lot of decisions that are made in fashion design are based on assumptions, because you have a fashion designer who comes up with a concept, because that's what we're taught. So you get a concept based on maybe a trend watcher or some inspiration that you got, and then you start designing without really knowing for whom you're designing, because you never had any contact with the customers. When we look at bigger fashion brands, they're also actually kind of doing the same, but then they also have sales reports. So they know what sold in the past collection and what didn't. But still, they don't know why something got sold or why it didn't get sold. So when trying to repeat the success, so like deciding to kind of redesign the same shirt again and then produce it again, but then change the material, can blow the success away, because maybe it was the material which made it so successful. So one of the biggest mistakes in the way fashion is being designed today is that there is no dialogue whatsoever between people who are going to wear the clothes and people who are actually designing it for them. And that motivated me to develop a new way of designing, a new design system. And this is the very first project where me and a partner of mine applied it to see how it actually works, because theoretically it worked perfectly and now you have to apply it. And it worked actually quite nice, because we sold our first early bird deal within 2 hours while we didn't have a web shop. And we have very committed customers. We have designed those sweatpants with 300 people from several countries who were just talking to us online. And everybody who's buying sweatpants from us now, they are making great photographs of themselves and promoting us actually for what we're doing. So this new way of designing that I'm talking about actually puts the consumer in the middle of the creation to see what do consumers really need. So it's not only about designers' creativity and vision, but it's about how this designer can use his creativity and vision to contribute as much as possible to the end users of the clothes. And we're talking about needs and desires about clothes. It's about physical needs and desires, so the way fabric feels on your skin, whether you're sweating or not, whether you're hot or not, whether it fits you or not. And then you have financial needs, so you have a budget, right? I mean, a garment can be like really beautiful, but if you don't have 1,000 euros and you can't afford it, you really get disappointed. But then you also have expectations. Maybe it is a very beautiful dress, but it's only 10 euros, and then you think, well, then maybe something is wrong with it. And you have psychological needs, and that's the psychological needs are actually the very base of why we wear clothes in the first place. So one of the psychological needs is decoration. You want to make yourself more beautiful, to get more attention, compliments. Another psychological motive is modesty, that you want to hide certain body parts or the changes in certain body parts, for example, when you gain weight after your boyfriend visited you from Cyprus. And then the last psychological motive is protection, that you don't want to get judged. And that one is very strong when you're going to apply for a job or you have to give a presentation, because you know, that's the very first thing people see about you is the clothes, not your hands or your face, what you're wearing. So if a fashion brand would know its target audience or target audiences, their consumers, and they would listen to those needs, they would have a very broad understanding of for whom they are designing and what the guidelines are in which they can design. Because this is one of, this is something I learned during one of the business trainings from Nisande Mehta from the Open Circles Academy. He says, well, there are four kind of reasons why we start business in the first place. Money, we want to earn money with what we do. We have something to give or to teach, to improve, so that's contribution. We want to do what we love, that's about passion, about growing in what you are already good in. And freedom, that you can choose what time to wake up, what to do, you have no rules, so you can decide all this. And then he said, if your reasons why you have a fashion brand or any other company are in these parts, then you're just doing a hobby. Well, if they are in all four of them, then you're working with a business. What he said was, hobby is money going out, and business is money coming in. And in order for money to come in, you need to contribute first. You have to have something to give first. And then eventually the money will come as well when you ask for it, when you're giving it. And that really fits with the design system that I'm talking about, because it's not only about your passion and your freedom as a designer, but it's about contributing to somebody's life with the clothes that you make. So how does this design system work? It has 5 steps, 12 tools up until now. And the very, very first step is just to listen. First of all, to define who is your target audience, and then to listen to what their needs are, what their frustrations are with certain clothes, what they're really searching for, what they're missing in their lives, what their budget is to spend, how often they buy clothes, etc. From this first step, you go to the next step where you can translate all that data that you received into the very first guidelines for design. For example, with the sweatpants, we made several of those sketches. They're not representing the sweatpants, but what we were asking was, for example, how high should the crotch be? Should it be really tight, or you know, a bit lower, or like really low? And why? Because we could also just listen to A, B, or C, or 1, 2, or 3. But the biggest reason why we ask these questions was to understand why somebody wants something, because that's where you understand the need or the desire. I believe that a fashion creator, so it's a designer or a brand, is still their responsibility to create and to design, but it would be easier when they listen first to what, you know, what people are searching for. This is a very first test moment to see whether the design is going in the right direction. From here on, you get, again, a lot of data. And from that data, you can make the very first samples that you get, give to the consumers as a fashion brand. And we did that with the early birds deal. We got a lot of feedback on that. But this third step of testing your designs is also very great in good marketing, because you give it to committed customers who are actually co-designing the sweatpants or any other garment with you. and they're going to be wearing it in their network, so to work or to in our case it was to the university and that kind of places, where their friends also see it and they ask, hey, well, what is that? And they start talking to each other, and word to mouth is the best marketing you have. It's much better than just having an advertisement in some kind of a magazine, because here trust is involved and people you trust are telling you about a certain fashion brand. So that is the second testing moment, where you can test the design to see if, first of all, it actually answers all the needs and desires, and secondly, how it behaves when it's made of fabric and not just sketched on a piece of paper. And as a fashion brand, if they do that, they know how big, first of all, their first market is, but they also have eliminated all the mistakes that they could have had, which would prevent a consumer from buying it. And this is the stage where they actually order the full batch production. And the fifth step of the design system is to keep having the dialogue, keep communicating how you're improving the next collections and so on, and listen to the feedback, give answers, give service, and just stay in contact with the customers. This design system, the advantages of it are that a design can be tested twice prior to production. That will save money, that is resources. It helps to build a committed market of customers. It helps to have goodwill, because people are actually in touch with you and they see how you create something. And up until now, I have worked with three fashion brands, and it was really nice to see how much people want to communicate about what they're missing or what they want, and how you can help them, how you can improve their daily life with good design. Because in my opinion, that's the role of designers, is to improve people's lives. Next to the design system, I also developed a business model that's making it possible to actually make more profit by being sustainable. First of all, clothes can be sold new, but they can also be loaned and sold secondhand. Instead of what's happening now, we have 30% of clothes not sold at all, 30% sold with great discounts, and only 30 to 40% that is sold for the real price. What would happen here? By the way, two examples of pioneers who are already loading clothes is Lena and Lady Bibliothek, and I provided them with some space in my book because I really believe in the concept. What would happen if the 30% overproduction would not be, like, if fashion brand would apply the design system, they would know which clothes not to produce, so they would not have it. What would happen then is that the expenses would drop. There are several expenses that, you know, get more, but there would be less expenses than now. I have written a blog about this, so you can read the full thing on my website later. And with the income, it would increase. So the expenses go down, income goes up, and there is more money available. With a part of that money will go into the service to the consumers, but another part of that money can go into the whole fashion chain. What is happening today is that a lot of NGOs are pushing the fashion brands to improve their fashion chain, right? But if a fashion brand is trying to survive because they have 30% overproduction and they don't know if it's going to get sold, if they're going to get their investments back, and somebody is saying, you need to also improve your fashion chain, it's too much. Well, if you can help them to make more money, which enables them to invest in the fashion chain and improve it, they are willing to do it. Nobody wakes up with the idea, I want to pollute the environment and harm people. You know, it just happens because someone is surviving. And that's where I'm focusing, because I want to help fashion brands to create this good fashion. And good fashion is not only environmentally friendly and ethical, but it's also profitable for the fashion brand, yet attractive and affordable for the consumers. And the creative space in the whole story is that designers and creative people, they have the ability to see solutions and to visualize them. Well, a lot of other people, they see what the problem is, but they can't really come up with a solution. And I think that if the communication would be better through a dialogue, much more would improve in life. So that's my role, helping fashion brands, testing some things out.